Welcome you all to this session on making a shift from offline to online contract management. I'm really glad to welcome our panelists, Ms. Camelea and Ms. Prerana, with me. A little bit of an introduction. Would you like to introduce yourselves, Prerana and Camelea, or should I go ahead?
As you like.
Sorry?
What do you prefer?
No, Camelea, you can introduce yourself.
Just okay.
Attendees.
Okay, so my name is Camelea Bounouar. I'm actually based in France. I'm a French Canadian citizen. Have almost 12 years as a contract manager in different businesses. Actually, I'm working in a food and beverage and industrial business. So I'm taking care of all world scope worldwide of the execution matters of in contract management, such negotiation of claims, amendments, and also taking care of French-speaking contracts. Before, I was in electrical industry and also in construction industry.
That's great. Prerana, would you like to go ahead?
Sorry, yes. Well, I have close to 6+ years of work experience as a legal counsel. I have worked with various organizations, starting with organizations that deal with mining in the FMCG sector. I'm currently associated with the healthcare and pharma sector. I'm working as a manager legal, currently handling all legal functions in the organization. Yes, that would be.
Thank you so much, Prerana. So the point here was that for the introduction was that we have a completely law person here, which is Prerana, and Camelea, who does not come from the law background, but has been a contract manager and deals with contracts day in and day out. So, you know, the discussion will be balanced, hopefully, and looking forward to the next entire session with both of you. So just to set the context here, we have seen that there are plenty contract lifecycle management tools available, not only in India, throughout the world. And slowly and steadily, a lot of companies are adopting these tools for their use. It could be companies, it could be firms, it could be anything else, and just for their contract management. So the point here is to understand whether the shift has been easy or whether it was required, and you know, who else to start this with other than Prerana, who has dealt with contracts day in and day out throughout your experience as you know, as a legal manager right now or in the past as well. So we have a few questions ourselves to propel this forward, and then we'll take on the questions from our audience as well. So another thing what we've noticed is how contracts are usually managed is through Excel. I mean, a CLM is I'll be referring to contract lifecycle management as CLM from here onwards, just so it's brief and comfortable for everyone. That every department has their own set of contracts, and all of them are stored in different Excel sheets. And then if someone leaves, it creates a problem for the team, and so on and so forth. So basically the management has been a little tedious. So starting with that, I'd like to begin the first question with, what do you think, how do in-house counsels or contract managers manage contracts offline? I mean, before, you know, you start with the online tool or the automation tool, how do you think it works offline? If you could just shed some light on that. Prerana, would you like to take that question first?
For sure. Now, I think when it comes to managing contracts offline, I think the process is rather cumbersome. It's a very time-consuming process whereby I think legal counsels, in-house legal personnel, or lawyers in general have to collate a lot of data, have to manage and coordinate with a lot of partners. We work largely on Excel, like you pointed out. We work a lot using Microsoft Office Word, where we first understand what the scope of work is, if the term sheet is negotiated, what the terms of the term sheet are, what the commercials are. Then we get on to manually drafting the contract. If an organization does not have standard templates, it's a rather time-consuming process again to sit down, draft the entire contract, and then the negotiation starts, which again is a cumbersome process. If the other party has shared their draft version, then you have to again sit down, review the entire agreement. There are a lot of approval mechanisms that you have to go through. You have to manage time of all the senior professionals that are there. If you can sit down, speak with them, understand the commercial aspects then. And this, I think there's a lot of decluttering, there's a lot of organizing, there's a lot of storing of documents, and all of this is the pre-execution stage. After you reach the execution stage, again, you have to take a printout. If it's an Indian document, there is stamp duty that is payable. You have to print it on a stamp paper. You have to courier it again. The document could get lost, so you have to keep track of where the document is going. Has it reached the other party on time? Then you have to get it signed. You have to get back the copy. If it's an overseas document, then my God, it takes a very, very long time to reach notices, etc. So I think offline, the process is rather lengthy. But the steps are that you have to review, negotiate all manually, read everything always. Post execution, I think if the business partners reach out to you for certain technical queries, again, you have to go find the document if you don't have a proper robust physical RMS system in place, track the clauses, then sit down with them, discuss again, coordinate with time. So it's a cumbersome process, but that's the process that we use.
So my takeaway from your answer is that basically it is time consuming because it is lengthy and because there are so many procedures involved that it the offline method is a little more time consuming than it should be. Camelea, can I ask you for your response to that?
For me, I share the same point of view as Ms. Prerana. Actually, I have experienced this in the past. I mean, in many countries, and until now, I can tell that there are some countries. In some countries, they still do this in paper. Not even they use word markups and everything, and they need, a contract to be stamped and signed. I mean, so it's a very time consumer, and also the quality of the document, it's very bad. And in the different of the generations, sometimes it's a huge contrast because people, they say, oh, how can I read 200 pages where I can just save time and just make a quick search in PDF or in Word. Other than that, also in the execution, I can tell that, if there is any issue, we have problems to collect records. And this is very, very important. Also in terms of archives, because now we have archives on drives, I mean, secure drive, we're going to talk about this after, but there are still some companies, as a procedure, they archive the documents like in a basement or something, and sometimes they get damaged. So if you have any issue to go and by the law in some countries, you need to keep it 20 years. Sometimes you find like a document, it's very, very damaged and you cannot, have any access to that. So yeah, it's very a nightmare.
Absolutely. So the offline method has not been very friendly for the users is my takeaway from both the answers. Moving on, something on the same lines is what was the first thing, when you heard about CLM or the first time that you came across a contract lifecycle management tool? So what were your first thoughts? Did you think that it was a little cumbersome, or did you think that yes, it was going to be a good tool in the long run? Prerana?
Well, I think when I first came across this concept of contract management tools, etc., I was rather relieved. My first takeaway from the tool was that I will readily have a dashboard that is available, which will tell me at all times what are the agreements I have in place. I could segregate the agreement customer-wise, nature-wise. I could automate all of the renewals. There will be a central repository to store all of the documents. I think more than that, I think all contract management tools need not have the feature, but there are quite a few in the market that have a feature which also allows the user to find So to make standard templates on the tool vis-a-vis giving recommendation to clauses, storing your clauses, giving insights on various important commercial pointers in the particular agreement. So I think these are a few things that I think of, or I thought of when I thought of a contract management tool, because these are the basic requirements of any organization. These are the activities that you have to do manually. And these are the activities where I think the legal resource of any organization spends most of their time. And I think this is the time that can be saved and utilized to better use that legal resource. So those would be my initial thoughts.
Absolutely, absolutely agreed with you. And this was going to be another question for me as to what features do you usually look for in a CLM tool, but I guess you've already answered that with the dashboard and with the templates and, you know, a repository which could be a storage for all the contracts that your company is either signing right now or has already executed. And of course, that's the basic that you would expect from a CLM tool. So thank you. Camelea, do we have you? I think there's an issue with Camelea, either it's the internet or it's okay. I think she can, we can continue with that later. Moving on, let's continue with the same question, Prerana. So you mentioned the repository and you mentioned templates and dashboard. Just want to know if there are more things that, I mean, I'm sure you've been in the business for so long and you know you must have seen tools yourself. Is there anything else that you think should stand out in a tool or which would really help the teams cut short their work? Because after all, anything and everything in the, that is, you know, any innovation in tech is used to make it easier for the user, cut short their time, things get automated, and just basically help any organization function better.
Well, so I think a good contract management tool must have quite a few features. So I think this is going to be my advice, that whenever any organization is looking out and trying to determine which contract management tool will better serve their purpose, I think you must first know what your objectives are, and you must first know what your internal manual workflow is, because that manual workflow has to get transferred online. And then this is my personal take, because this is my requirement. The first is going to be with it aiding business functions. Now, when I speak about aiding business functions, I mean that it is just going to simplify a lot of the functions, right? When your business partners have to reach out to the legal function to draft an organization, they can just log on to the tool. There's going to be no toggling between Outlook and Word at all times. Again, when the legal function has to respond to the business team, there's going to be no toggling again between the Word and the email and browsing through the various enormous versions that we have, numerous versions that we have, comparing all of them, figuring out what the issues are. So I think this is one biggest importance. Functional efficiency, again, is going to be, because I think a lot of contract management tools have various machine learning features, because of which it becomes very, very easy to review agreements. I think that saves a lot of time. So that is the efficiency aspect. I think this is where I think we should all, I think, understand that a legal resources mind can be utilized to do a lot of things, advisory, litigation, etc., rather than doing the clerical job of going to the agreement every day, reading the same clauses every day, and clarifying the same to the business partners. So I think that is one very important thing. The other important thing, I think, is also going to be to understand and determine maverick spending, which is going to be where we are not aware if when it comes to the financial teams, they're always trying to determine if the expenditure is being made following all of the SOPs or not. So there are compliance teams set up, there are investigation teams set up to determine this at all times. I think with the CMS tool, you can very easily track your maverick spending, because you know the expenditure that you're going to make basis the commercial clauses in the agreement. So I think the machine learning feature really helps there a lot. I think it really increases visibility of the suppliers that you have, of the products that you have. With the help of the dashboards, you can very easily determine what are the agreements that you have pending. You can segregate them on the basis of supplier, product, etc. This is what I have done with my tool, and I really find that very, very helpful. I think it also helps with compliance obligations, like payment obligations, when you're required to make the payments, when you're required, what is the lead time for delivery, etc., if you're in the manufacturing supply sector. So all of your obligations, your payments, because there are certain agreements now that are also subject to auto renewal, right? So if you're availing services, and if you're not aware, you want to say you want to terminate the agreement, and you fail to do that, the agreement is subject to auto renewal, so now it has got an auto renewal. So you're going to face a commercial impact of that particular auto renewal. So I think a few of these features really come in handy.
If someone's building a tool right now, they'll be very helped by all the points that you've noted and all the features, because you have, I think, listed out everything that one would need or want from a CLM tool, no matter what. So thank you for covering almost everything. Camelea, would you like to add something to that? I think we lost you a bit in the middle.
Yeah, sorry, I lost the internet. But for me, based on my experience, there is something very important that we shall not ignore when we are taking like such a tool, which is change management. Because sometimes, companies, they take a lot of money and they do a lot of trainings to make people use the tool. And then they just say, okay, people, they are obliged to use it, but they don't, take it serious that people, they're going to resist on that. So in some companies, we are still, and I can tell you, based on my actual experience, still the old people, they are not using the old tools that we put into their disposal. And then it creates a very internal conflict, and also a loss of information, a double work, which is a huge, and sometimes also it can go to lose of some opportunities and lose of some critical cases.
Absolutely, thank you for adding that. I think that was the only thing left
sorry, I lost internet, I couldn't hear everything, but now it's set up, now I'm settled up.
Even if you missed it, it was completely, I think everything is in line, because everything else was spoken about by Prerana very rightfully and very justly, because again, experience really, really counts here. Okay, so moving on to the next question that we have. So Prerana just mentioned machine learning. What about artificial intelligence? I mean, it's a term thrown around everywhere, not only in CLM, but everyone in the tech industry or every other industry is just throwing around artificial intelligence as if it's the new term and it's the new fad. What do you think? Does AI help contract management, or can it be incorporated, or can it in any way ease the life of a contract manager by doing some or the other tasks in a CLM tool? Any thoughts on artificial intelligence? Camelea, would you like to go first?
Yes. Yeah. So actually, for me, I can tell all the businesses and all industries without any exception, they are using artificial intelligence. And it's actually just a simple tool that a computer can manage, the same intelligence that a human can manage. So for example, in a contract management, for me, it's very, very helpful in case that when we enter an information about an opportunity, about a risk regarding the opportunity, a type of a business, and any information that we have about this opportunity, so a computer can this tool can refer to us different clauses that it can be inspiring and useful for us. It can remind us about critical dates also in the execution. It can refer to us some certificates that might be a good tool that we integrate as a template. It can also remember us about financial risk that we can have. So it can refer us templates about the warranties, the LCs, and everything. And in any, phase in the contract management, in the execution, it can also give us thoughts and examples and refer us to some, critical dates, opportunities that we can take, risks that we shall take into consideration. So it's really really important for me. It's the future, so we shall really take it into consideration and take it as a part of the process while choosing either a tool or managing it.
All right. I think that was well explained. But do you have any specific example, Camelea, where you think artificial intelligence can play a role? Anything specific do you think, apart from, like you told me, how generally artificial intelligence is there in almost every industry and how it plays a role? But anything else that you would like to add?
I have an example, actually, that I'm seeing now in the medical industry. So they are using tools in the management of the treatments and everything. So they enter in every, and it's an application. They enter all, all the information regarding the case. For example, my husband is in the dentist industry. So they enter everything, the scans and everything. And I mean, the intelligence, artificial intelligence, they give them everything, the steps, when they're gonna do the checkup, when they're gonna do the revision, every single thing. Also, I mean, the certificates that they can issue, the paper, really it does the work that a human can do. Yeah.
Thank you so much for that example as well, Camelea. Prerana, would you like to add something on that?
Yeah, well, I have, likewise, I think that AI is, I think, a very, very hot topic these days. People are really talking a lot about AI, especially the voice automated AI, the OK Google systems that we have in place, the Alexa home systems that we have in place, the smart home concept that we have in place. Now, if you link this concept to agreements and contracts and the contract management tool, currently, there is still a little bit of manual work that you have to do in your contract management tool. But imagine, you know, one Sunday morning, if you get up and you want an insight on how many agreements you were executed, say in the past month, and all you have to do is say, okay, Alexa, please tell me how many agreements were executed. And you get a response that say you've executed like from 30 agreements. And you don't even have to, you know, take in the effort of just logging into the tool. So I think that would be something that is very, very cool. And I think it is not so far off. This development. But coming to the actual AI that we currently have with you, exactly, I think the most important AI machine learning feature that all contract management tools must have and usually have also is the suggestive clauses tool. I will take an example to explain this. Say there are two ways in which these suggestive clauses can help you. One is, say you are working on a supply agreement and your organization really works on supply agreements quite a bit, all right? And your supply agreements, say, have clauses of minimum commitment, guarantee, indemnity, intellectual property, and say
one of the clauses.
Yeah, and say either you are working or drafting a new agreement yourself, or you have received an agreement from another vendor and it is a supply agreement. The tool with its AI machine learning will realize that it's a supply agreement and will give you a suggestion that, boss, listen, this is a supply agreement. And usually in your supply agreement, you include a minimum commitment clause, but this agreement doesn't have it. Do you want to include the minimum commitment clause? And it will give you that standard language that your organization is okay with. So there are two things that are happening here. One is you're getting a suggested clause of a minimum commitment. Two, you're getting the clause that is already aligned with all of the business partners in your organization internally. So you don't again have to take the effort of going through the internal approval mechanisms. All you have to do is just include that clause in the agreement. The other thing that can also happen with this AI is that when you keep typing in clauses in the agreement, those clauses are bound to get stored in the repository of your contract management tool. So when you're making standard contracts, when you're making a contract from scratch, those languages will again help you quite a bit. So I think these two features currently in the AI are very, very important, other than the other features that the CMS tool has to offer.
So that's a very specific feature, Prerana, but I get that from both of you that contract AI's role in contract management does exist and it is bound to make it better in the future. Of course, artificial intelligence is still in the developing stage, and however much we claim there is a lot of manual intervention still involved. I mean, so far what we know is 70 to 80% accuracy is what is offered by AI, and let's say maybe we move on to 90% and more accuracy, and it'll do wonders to every industry, I'm sure.
Yeah, absolutely. I forgot to mention this one point when we talk about auto renewals and all. That also, I think, heavily relies on the AI and the insight searches that the CMS tools will have to offer, other than manually also interning, setting up your timelines. But I think AI really helps with that also at times. It definitely, I think AI is, it's like the beating heart of the contract management tool.
AI is here to stay, and it is here to stay to make all of our lives easier.
Hopefully.
All right, that's as much on AI. Moving on, okay, so let's talk about security. Everything right now and every case law that we see in India, abroad, everything is related to data security. So knowing that all of these or most of these CLM tools are on the cloud, how secure do you think they are, or do you think there are still more security measures that need to be taken by companies? And would you be willing to, you know, give your data to a CLM tool, knowing that it's on cloud? And how does security work for you? Camelea, would you like to take that?
Yeah, for me, I mean, each company with their domain, I'm not an IT engineer, but based on my experience, what I'm seeing, for example, with my company and my other previous companies, I mean, they don't use general like Gmail or like a cloud, like this not secure. They have a secured space by the domain. For example, at SPX, we are domain spx.com. So everything, I mean, all the security rules are adapted, and only those emails that are, I mean, spx.com, they can access, I mean, with some access codes. And, you know, no suppliers, no customers, they cannot just access like that. They need to give, I mean, we need to give them special access. We need to link up with the IT. To be honest, I mean to adapt the tool to the company's rules or to the company's domain, to the company's network, I'm not worried about security at all. Of course, there are always like hackers that they can hack all the companies, I guess, without exception. I mean, the received spam emails. I'm one of those that I receive like 20 or 30 spam emails per day. But by keeping doing training, train people that we should not click to any link. We should not just give access without any IT, protocol. The information is in good security or is in between good hands. Also, there is confidentiality agreements when we give access to other people so they cannot modify such things. Once again, I'm not an IT engineer, but this is from my practical experience that I have and I use in a daily basis.
Okay, so that's actually pretty much all that security would cover, Camelea. But Prerana, would you like to add something to that?
I think I'm pretty much aligned, and I really agree with all points that Camelea has made. Now, my opinion only subjected to the way the in-house team uses legal contracts, and when it comes to the CMS tool, I'm sure there are quite a few. Now, there is risk with everything. I think every tool or every engagement that you would want to take on, a simple purchase deal will also have quite a few risks. Now, you just have to find ways to mitigate it, and you have to realize the benefits that it has to offer vis-a-vis the downside, how it balances out, which is benefiting you or which is scaring you more. And depending on that, I think you need to go ahead with it. Of course, you must know if your organization, coming exactly to the contract management tool, if your organization really reads a contract management tool, if so, how, and how are you going to get it in place, etc. Now, coming to the cloud-based tools that are largely available, at least in the Indian market, when it comes to contract management tools, these cloud-based tools it definitely comes at a cost which is lower than setting up the entire system in-house at your own place, in your own server, etc., because you save on the hardware cost, which is very, very costly, at least in the Indian jurisdiction. Now, when you're using these cloud-based softwares, it definitely comes with a risk. But there are a lot of mitigation plans, I think, that are available in the market. And because I think you can comprehensively and very strongly save yourself from all of these risks, I think taking on a contract management tool, of course, with every change, there's a little bit of resistance, but I think there are a lot of pros. So I would recommend everybody, if your organization really needs it, there are a lot of documents that you're into, because I think for any legal team, documentation is like the backbone. It's like the 70 to 80% of the work that you do is all on documents, right? So the biggest, I think, thing that you can do to mitigate these risks are going to be get cyber insurance policies in place, ensure that your data on the tool is always encrypted. But you're always supposed to be wary of this, that the more you encrypt your data, the slower the tool will work. But by slower, I don't mean it's going to take hours to give you your document. You probably won't even realize. Instead of 1 minute, you'll probably get it in 2 minutes. And I think 2 minutes is also rather a very, very long period of time. Instead of getting it like some 2 seconds, you'll get it in 30 seconds. That's going to be the time difference. So I think if we focus on a few things, like GDPR is always there outside globally. In India, our data protection bill has been currently withdrawn, but nevertheless, it's going to get tabled soon. It is the need of the hour. It is going to get passed. And when it does get passed, I think localization is going to become a very, very big important aspect. So a few things to bear in mind is that when you onboard a tool, you have to have several backups in place. If one fails, you have another place. So backups have to be in various, basically spread over. In the Indian territory, the data has to be in India, it cannot be stored outside. If you bear a few things in mind, insurance, again, cyber insurance is something very, very important. All organizations must have one. And ensure encryption. I think these would be a few methods where you can secure your data on the tool very effectively.
The 2 seconds that you mentioned, the 2 second lag is too small to not have a system in place if you can trust the vendor and do you think signing NDAs or security agreements apart from your usual agreements with these tools if you sign a non-disclosure and you make sure that there are provisions such as all the data is encrypted and no one can go through it, no one can break down the information and then pass it on. Do you think that should be spelled out as correctly right now? Because like you said, the data protection bill is not in place right now, but I'm sure we'll have something or the other coming soon. And security is a very big issue worldwide. It's not India. It's not an issue, actually. It's of great importance. And what do you think? Should there be separate agreements signed for that, or any thoughts on that?
Well, of course, I think this is a basic, and NDA before initiation of any deal, no matter what the size of the deal is, I think is very important. You must always sign a non-disclosure agreement. It is very, very important. Depending on how you're going to utilize the tool, if there's going to be a lot of personal data on it. We currently have under the IT policy, sensitive personal data rules under Section 43A frame. I think in compliance with that, if organizations have a privacy policy, it's very essential also to sign protection of sensitive personal data agreements. You can include personal data also in it. I think that should be governed by precedents and case laws that we have in place, but sensitive personal data is definitely under the rules covered. So these two aspects go 100%. And when you're onboarding a tool, it's always, I think, also essential to execute a service agreement. So you know what you're going to get out of the tool, how they're going to help you with the CMCA, MC activity, etc., with the transition from manual to online with your agreements, etc. So I think all this is the first step. This is very obvious.
Yes, while onboarding, this is the first thing to make sure that the vendor or the tool which you are trying to collaborate with is in place when it comes to security systems. So
and for me, the NDA actually, as Prerana said, it's a procedure, it's a protocol with all the companies. But the problem, for example, when you go and try to present an CLM tool to a customer and you tell him you will not tell him you need just an NDA to put the NDA in place and you are safe, because this is even offline, you do an NDA. The problem here is, to show them the security, and as I told you, I'm not an IT engineer, but I mean, this is one of the tools and one of the what we call it, one of the advantages that you need to explain to the customer and how they're going to be protected, you know, if there is an intrusion to their system. Because the NDA, I mean, evidence design NDA, it will not be from a customer, maybe it will be from a third party that you know, a hacker that you need to access to have, I mean, access to sensitive documentation. So yeah, for me, there is two aspects, like with the direct and also to prevent any intrusion to the system.
Absolutely, because we're talking about sensitive data here when it comes to agreements of any organizations. So there we have it for security. Again, the next question is related to acceptability. Now we've been talking about CLM for so long, and I don't know if either of you have actually incorporated it or not, but from a general understanding with your years of experience, do you think the concept of CLM has gained acceptability in India and abroad? I mean, of course, Prerana, you'll have to take the Indian side, and Camelea can give me, answer based on what she has seen around. Is there acceptability in general, or like Camelea mentioned, that people are set in their old ways and it's a little difficult to, adapt? And of course, any change will always take time. And especially when it comes to technology, because there's always resistance. There's always resistance, and there will be resistance, no doubt. But it's been a while since CLM has been in the market, and the word has been going around for a few years now. So do you think now the companies or corporates in general are inclined towards incorporating CLM within their organization? Camelea?
For me, based on my experience abroad, all the companies, the tendency is that is to implement tools such CLM, such other tools, you know, such ACP that they integrate some models, and it can be as a tool, as a CLM tool, for example, such other sites like many contracts and others. But it's, from as a strategic choice, yes, it's gained acceptance and it's gained demand, and all the companies, for me, without exceptions, they are, the tendency is to, and it's in their strategy, internal or external development, they are willing to do that. They want to do that if it's not already in place. And even if it's in place, there is always, upgrades to take to manage it on the other sides. As I said, practical, to practice it, to follow it, I can tell not 100% follow. And here, the parts that for me should be a big part of the process, as you said, and as I said before, for the change, that people need to follow it as to have it as a success. Because, for example, for my company, we have it and we use it. But when, for example, you have a template, like a beautiful template that from these tools and you get it, you should also, there is another stage to avoid the copy paste. Because sometimes when you have like a very, you spend time to construct it by, having information entered. And then when you have it, it doesn't mean that it will be the super template and the tool, it's died. You will not need it anymore. So for me, this is an important part that it should be also a continuous training to people to do it. But for me it's ongoing. And even when there is sometimes resistant people, they when they use it one and twice, they see that it's not to replace them by a machine, it's not to that they don't do things well. It just and we bring some other third party, because usually it's not an internal developed tool unless like in a huge companies like GE and stuff. But usually it's a third party that it's adapted to the system. So people, they finish by use it, but it should be continuous. So for me, any third party or like a party that they're going to develop such a tool, it should be in the process to make it a success and to make it acceptable. That a continuous training, a continuous follow-up, and then for sure it will be a success to both parties, and also it will open doors to both parties. Sometimes it's simple, tools, you know, like that you say, oh yeah, people, they're gonna adapt it, it's adapted to the system, but it's very simple. But the to make it like an algorithm and the tool itself, it's very important to make it as a brand of the tool, as a definition of the tool. Yeah.
Okay, thank you for that, Camelea. And so what I've got from your answer is that there is acceptability now, I mean, so far as you've seen, and it's there in your organization,
yes,
as slowly and steadily, that there will be more. But the acceptability has started. It's there's less resistance now. Prerana, what
absolutely,
do you,
yes.
Do you concur with that, or do you have some something to add?
No, I definitely, I think, concur with that. Like I've told you before, there is definitely resistance to change, but it is definitely needed. So I understand exactly where Camelea is coming from. In every organization, I think, I realized through my experience, at least in India, that legal teams seem to be pressing a lot on digitizing as many processes as we can, because it saves a lot of time. We can utilize the resource elsewhere. There's been a very recent study that Gartner had conducted, whereby we realized that some 60-80% of users are now deviating towards intangible services, and I think a contact management tool is one such service. Now, the biggest challenge, I think, depending again on the size of the organization, because I don't think large organizations will have an issue when it comes to micro level, small level, mid level organizations, startups. I think, but again, I think you can include large level organizations also. The biggest challenge is venturing out into the market, finding out how many tools are there, looking at the cost, taking the demo, comparing the features. I think this is what consumes most of the time. But if you don't get bogged down by this entire process, and you know what you exactly want, and you find the software and you onboard the software, I think it will really, really help you save a lot of time, starting from review to negotiation to the post-execution activities of insight, discussing, getting an insight on the commercial impact that it made, the contract is going to have on you, reminders, etc., all of that. Now, I think the biggest issue, I think, with the legal fraternity is we're all used to that old school book flip method, huh, where you want to sit down with a pen and a paper and a highlighter and do all of that business. But I think ESG is the biggest talk of the town. When you're speaking of ESG, I mean environment, social, and governance. Now, with automation on time, on your renewals, etc., on the AI that you can use for insight, I think your governance aspect gets really, really covered. And then when we talk about environment and sustainability, every organizations trying to reduce their carbon footprint, all nations making promises of net zero, etc., I think the more you digitize your process, the more it becomes easier for you to reduce the impact that you're having on the environment. Now, again, this is a very, very small bit of it, because I think the energy sectors, etc., have a very major role to play on this with regards to how, and the manufacturing sector with how they discharge their waste, the products that they are manufacturing, etc. This is a very, very minor role, but it's a beginning, right? So I think if you try to focus on this aspect also, definitely there's going to be resistance, but it's a cultural change, right? The more you talk about it, the more it will get inculcated in the minds of the players. And again, if I'm not wrong, there was a study by IDC, if I'm not wrong, which stated that mostly the pharma sector, the healthcare sector, industry is deviating towards all of these intangible tools more and more, and they are trying to accept contract management tools as much as possible. And I come from the pharma sector, so I know over here at least we are definitely, it's hard, right? It's really hard to bring a change, but for all of the contract manufacturing tools, all of the contract tool manufacturing folks out there, I think it's a task which is going to be rather uphill. But I think you can sit on a very nice tractor if that goes uphill, because there are very good mitigation mechanisms that you can have. And this is their time here. I think COVID has taught us that you can sit in-house and you can sit in your house, right, and work. You don't need to come to office. You can use Teams to coordinate, to adjust. During COVID, since we couldn't get the documents physically signed, I think the courts again and again, the Indian courts, have again and again clarified and stressed on the fact that e-signatures, etc., is possible. So again, I think COVID has played a major role in this, yeah, to say that even if you can resist it, I think online digitization, e-agreements is the way to go.
Absolutely. I'm glad you brought up the point of environment and sustainability, Prerana, because I mean, apart from this being automation and, you know, greater than technology and other things, it also helps the environment. I mean, there were a few websites I've myself seen which also advocate that, you know, CLM is not only just reducing your time and, you know, helping you with your organizational requirements, but also maybe give it a thought that it's environment friendly, because like you mentioned, I'm a lawyer and I'm still sitting with a pen even though I'm not writing anything. That's how used to we are with regards to a pen and paper, that we have to have it around. While it's so important to understand that this is not how it should continue, because we cannot let it continue like that. I mean, day in and day out in my organization where we work, we try and reduce paperwork as much as possible. We roam around with our laptops and everything, because I mean, it may be a drop in the ocean, but at least it's something. And if a lot of companies actually shift to CLM, and like you mentioned, with e-agreements and e-signatures and all of that takes place, then there is just so much that will be helped, because I mean, agreements are bundling. I mean, I've myself dealt with agreements which are 200 plus pages, and of course there's versioning, like you mentioned. There are sometimes I mean, before all of this, just imagine if there was even a 20 pager agreement and it was exchanged between parties. And then onwards, edits were made. Just imagine the number of papers that were used, and they would all be shredded, and it would lead to nothing. Why are we doing that? And I'm so glad that you brought this up without me having to prompt. You know that environment has a role to play as well, and all of us have some real responsibility towards it.
And you have some customers sometimes. I don't know, I haven't really understood, but it happens. Sometimes they want to have four original copies.
Yes.
So like stamped and I don't know, like original paper. So, and it's a lot of paper, you know, for the environment, we feel bad. But I mean, it's not now, like before it was often, now it's still, I mean, starts to disappear, but still there are some that they want four papers.
Like Prerana mentioned, it's a cultural change, because it actually is like that sometimes clients want, people want that there should be as so many copies of this. And I mean, a general passport office will also require you to have so many photocopies and so many copies of things. And I mean, this is maybe the lawyer community is now going to be a little bit more responsible with using tools of for contracts and for other document management and everything like that, which just not only reduces paperwork, it obviously helps reduce time. And I think it's just less cumbersome. And that's what I'm getting out of both of you. So that's great. So let's move on to the next part, which is, I mean, negotiations. So how do you think CLM helps in negotiating online? I mean, do you think an online negotiation helps or is in any way better? Because I understand that we are used to the manual way that, you know, you send, you draft your agreement, then you send it over, and then there are some changes made, and there's a lot of to and fro involved. While when it is done through a CLM tool itself, there may be edits made right then and there, and you know, not only does that reduce time, do you think that helps, or do you think the manual way was better? Prerana?
But I think the manual was definitely not better, to answer your question in short. But when you use a tool, I think I've personally been using a certain tool, and how it has helped me cut short on my time is with a few aspects. Like, I focused a lot on the machine learning features, so the metadata that it captures, the insights that it provides, I think really helps. One, make a high-level review, and in the high-level review, you After you've gone through quite a few agreements over a period of time, I think you realize, depending on the nature of the agreement, what would be the places that you would want to focus on. But even if you have to go through the entire agreement, I think the insights feature really help you focus on a few important aspects that are your non-negotiables, to understand what are the points that you would want to negotiate with. So the AI and the metadata really helps you in that. So it definitely reduces the negotiation timelines. I think your capability to view real-time changes, central storage, I think the digital redlining that is provided, your capability, I think, to readily have clauses that are acceptable to your organization makes your stance really very clear, right? So when you're negotiating clauses, you, even if the language is going to be somewhat different, instead of I and R, you're using the term dollars, depending on where the agreement is, it's a very minor change. I'm just using this as an example. It will definitely have a commercial impact, but without getting into that. If we just focus on interplay of words also, we still know what is the basic premise of the language that my organization is okay with. So I think these things will definitely provide so-called skeleton that will really, really help reduce time. And like I've told you before, this toggling that, you know, we lawyers have to do at all times with Word and Microsoft, I think this is really cut short, yeah. A lot, to a very, very large extent, because you're just on that tool. The business partner raises a request on that tool. You work on the agreement and you send it off on that tool. And then the business partner sends it off to the external party, or you can send it off to the external party using the tool. Yeah, you can include the external partner on the tool in certain contract management tools. So it really helps you save time. And if you're working with the, pardon me?
I think all of it is in then one place instead of
absolutely. It central repository is a very, very helpful thing, yeah. And then once you have a central repository, I think the dashboard does a marvelous job. Every time you have the management asking you what is the status of this agreement, what is the commercial impact of the agreements, etc., so you have it all readily available at a click of a button at your repository, which I really, really love. Because imagine making an MIS for some 300 agreements that you have, and 300 agreements is something that I'm saying is very, very less. I think organizations are going to have some 600,000 agreements at any point of that. And you have to sit down, you have to go through all of those agreements, sit down and make an MIS of those agreements, present it to the management. With one customer also, you can land up having numerous agreements, you understand? So with those numerous agreements also, it will so be that you agree to a certain indemnity clause with for a certain nature of a transaction that you're having with one customer. And with that customer, when you're doing a sale agreement, or you're doing a supply agreement, or you're doing a manufacturing agreement, you can have various nature of agreements, right, with just one customer also. And imagine you discuss different indemnity clauses at all times. Why would you want to do that? So the insight clause, I think, is really, really going to help you. You have to identify that this is what we had agreed before. This was the governing clause, because these are some voluntary things that are going to be there in your agreement. So why renegotiate it? Like arbitration clause, why renegotiate it? Yeah? This is the language that we had agreed. This is the language that we will look at again. Because teams also, again, keep changing at all times. I think with this great attrition that we have currently going on and everybody talking about, I think the standardized clauses and the metadata machine learning tool really helps to reduce time in negotiating everything.
That's really well covered, Prerana, because like you said, I mean, everything will be at the same place and all the versioning and everything will be reduced, because negotiating will be definitely easy when it's inside one tool and there's just to and fro and different parties raising requests. There's no overlap and so on and so forth. Camelea, do you have something to add to what Prerana just said?
Yeah, I can add things from the practical point of view, from the applicable point of view. Actually, in addition to what Prerana said, there is a very, for me, important aspect that these tools give you traceability. Who does what? Who touch which document? And also, you know that nobody is permanent as an organization. People, they got sick, they got to a business trip, they got to a leave. And then, I mean, here, when we were doing things offline, it was like the information and the file was owned by a person. With these tools, a file and the case, it's not owned by a person. It's owned by a department. It's owned by the company. So all the people, they can easily access. They can easily know where are the documents. And also toward the customer, so we can, I mean, we will have a tools to build a relationship in case to see when are the things are going, what is missing, what is not missing, what we need to do, and to explain easily to them that we are taking care and we know who's doing what, and we can, I mean, have strong record from also from a practical perspective and execution while negotiating. You have, in addition to that, you have access to the files all the time. It can easily win time when you are exchanging information internally as externally. And also papers, I mean, as we say, there's a proverb in France, it says like words fly and records stay. So we will have always traceability at any stage of the contract. And this is helps. It gives, you can show to the customer that it has a value. So he's a potential one because we are taking care. We are professional when we are negotiating. Said, here, you sent us this at this time. We did this and this and this. And here our results. And, you know, negotiation, it's not like it costs $1. No, I need it at 0.5 and we shake hands and that's it. It's a long process. So we need to build it to build a story if we want to really to have a customer for a life. So you need to always have this story. And also if something happens, it's a part of the negotiation to create a record. So it saves a lot of time when you are dealing with a client. So yes, absolutely. Yes, it's really facilitate the negotiation. And also it serves as a tool for negotiations as well.
I think time efficiency has been the key word in the entire past hour. With every question that we've dealt with, it's always been how time will be, you know, saved and how things will be efficient. So I'll just ask the last question in my segment and then we'll move on to the audience questions, is that we've spoken about how good CLM is and how it saves time and everything, but do you think there are some negatives to it as well? I know we've covered security already, but again, that can be taken care of with the right systems and with the right agreements and clauses. But do you think there are some pitfalls, some challenges still with regards to CLM in general, maybe with regards to some tools you've seen or an issue that you have faced that, you know, there's still a long way to go. So any challenges that that come to your mind regarding CLM? Camelea?
You know, as we say, nobody is perfect. So like nothing is perfect in the world. The thing here from my point of view is for me, a CLM, it will not replace 100% a human. And the human will not replace 100% a CLM. So if we build a tool, it's to give us strength, okay? It's to give power, force, is to give flexibility to the organization, is to help people who are negotiating. But if people, they think that, okay, we have a CLM, I know how to use it 100% and he's gonna do the job on my behalf and ignore the other aspects, the steps of the we call the stage gate or the internal procedures, because a CLM, you know, you think that you're gonna do this in your place. For me, it's not the case. So it's not a negative. It's maybe to be aware, to not create negative aspects of the thing. So to not, I mean, it's not kind of a warning, but for me, it's a tool. I mean, to not make it be a negative instead of taking fruits of its implementation is actually to follow and to train people. So for me, this is not let ignorers be installed. For me, this is what we call it. It might be a negative if we don't take care. Yeah.
Manual intervention is important while implementing a CLM.
Exactly.
My takeaway from what you've said, Prerana, would you like to add something?
Well, I completely agree. Manual intervention is definitely important, but a few challenges I think that organizations might face is, let's starting with a few. One is going to be choosing the right kind of tool, because there are so many options that are available in the market. So like I've spoken about this earlier also, I think getting a demo, comparing the tools, comparing the cost, etc. When it comes to costs also, I think there are quite a few tools that are available in the market that are either appropriately priced or overpriced. I think depending on the size of the organization and their appetite and their basically their affordability, how much cost they can pay and afford the contact management tool, depending on how eagerly they need it. I think these would be a few things. Maybe for in-house counsels and organizations, because the change is resisting, I think taking that task of reaching out to the management and convincing them that the tool is definitely important and the investment is going to be worth it because the returns are definitely beneficial. I think that would be one. And the second one, I think, would be that although we are digitizing everything and encryption, there's that, cyber insurance will definitely help. I think there are various issues of ransomware and data acceleration. That could be an issue where either in ransomware, the data is encrypted against you and they will not release it or give it to you unless you pay a ransom, or in data exfiltration where they will decrypt your data and say that you will leak your confidential data into the market. I think these could be a few challenges, but these are certain challenges that even if you don't have a contract management tool in place, you will be subjected to. So this is irrespective.
You've made the question redundant that, you know, one film tool, no matter the evils that come with it, because of course it's a baby right now. I mean, everything is still building and there's so much more that has to take place, and there's so much more building to do with CLM across the world, I think, and it's a continuous process right now. And I just like to add how much I love how you mentioned so many times that lawyers are resistant to change. I completely relate to that, and that is how we start most of our conversations. Being in the legal tech company, that will the legal industry be ready for this? Will they want to make this kind of change? How much time do you think it will take for them to adopt this kind of a change in their day-to-day functioning? So glad that we all agree on that. So I'm going to begin with a few audience questions, and I'll just take one at a time so that, I mean, we don't have repeated answers, and as it is, we're almost running short. So one of the questions is, are there any know-hows of CLM that you would like to share? I think more or less it was covered, but Prerana, any thoughts on any know-how of CLM that you would like to share?
When it comes to know-how, I think if the user wants to understand, or the person who's asked the question, basically, if he wants an insight on what should be the features of your contract management tool, basically just to start, I think there are a lot of contract management tools that are available in the market. You need to be aware of what your ask is, why you want the tool, and what your organization's budget is. After you've determined that, I think a few basic features that you must look for in a contract management tool is machine learning, dashboard, renewal automation. I think these are the basics. And of course, capability for standardizing agreements. I think these are the basics, and there are various additional features that a lot of contract management tools have to offer, but this would be basic because the metadata is going to help you understand what are the key essential features of the agreement, which is what you need. It is going to provide a central repository, which will help in your dashboard, which is what you need. Because when it comes, it is during the time of, very simply put, for in-house counsels, during the time of our appraisals, MIS is something that is required to be presented. Right. And when you have to do that, there are various juniors that are sitting down trying to determine as a team how many agreements that they have worked on. So the dashboard is going to help you with that. If the renewals are automated, you can readily ask your business partners if you want to renew the agreement. If you don't want to renew the agreements will not be subject to auto renewal. You will be able to firsthand determine how many termination notices you have to send. There'll be a central repository to find, locate documents as soon as possible and get insights on the documents, understanding what the impact and what the clauses are of the agreement. So I think these would be a few features that one must look at.
All right. I think that covers up the question. Camelea, I'd like to ask you the next question. So one of the questions that have been raised is, how should companies prepare for implementing CLM within their organization? I know we've covered a bit of it already, that, you know, companies need to prepare.
For me, I can cover it very short because I guess we are running out of time. For me, is we need to know how to manage change. It's a training. To make a proper training to make people understand why we are doing this and how it's going to facilitate their lives. We can say this like in a normal expression, and also keep making them aware about this tool, about the importance for the company, because they are making a lot of money, but how they can progress well, how they can perform well. So if I can resume the question in two words, is to manage the change, because it will be a huge change in the beginning. Maybe it will not be easy for them. Maybe they will not understand it, but at the end, they will understand how their life can be super easy. And also it helps their persons, because they can, take time to develop themselves, to learn other things, to grow in the company. So for me, it's very important to manage a change. Yeah, I can tell.
Right. So again, this is a huge change, and implementing the CLM tool can be a little difficult for companies. But what you're trying to say is that this has to be managed, because again, like we've said, that it has almost become a necessity with regards to how an organization works. So it's better to adapt to it rather than, you know, keep thinking about how big of a change it could be and how it could affect otherwise. So one of the last questions, Prerana, is that how do you calculate the return on investment post you implement a CLM? I think what they're trying to ask is, once the CLM has been you have started working on the tool, it's obviously an investment, whether big or small, that depends on the organization, like you just mentioned a few minutes ago. So how do you think you would calculate the ROI? Based on the manual work, which is, you know, shortened, and maybe some work that has increased, which is feeding in the data and all?
Well, I think there are two ways of looking at this. The first is going to be, like you pointed out, the time and energy of your resource that you're going to save on doing this pointless activity of storing the document, removing the document, searching for the document, finding the clause, determining what the organization's standard practice is. I think all of this time that you will save of your particular resource is going to be utilized at the more beneficial stage of advisory, etc. So this man hours that you save and utilize, better utilization of the resource, I think is going to be one of the major returns. And the other return is going to be, with all organizations, I think everybody wants to grow. The goodwill is very, very important to organizations. And after organizations reach a certain level, money does not remain that important, because they have a lot of liquidity and they're always AAA rated, etc. So even at that stage though, right, if you use a particular tool and you help the organization understand what is the commercial impact of every contract, which contract language could have been drafted better. There are, so I will give you an example, okay, because this is a very, very personal example that, you know, our organization has dealt with. And we could have done it only with the help of a contract management tool. There are certain agreements that have, because I am in the manufacturing sector, so there were a few of the manufacturing and supply sector, there were a few agreements that we had signed where what we were speaking about was that now, since we're into the supply sector also, there were certain players who had reached out to us to manufacture a certain product, right? And the clause that dealt that we were dealing with basically stated that X would be the price if you, say, order 300 units from me, and Y will be the price if you order 100 units from me, right? And the Y price is definitely higher than the X price. How do you determine all of this? How do you get an insight of all of this? How do you keep a track of all of this? I think the CMS tool, the contract lifecycle management, or the contract management tool, the insight feature, is definitely going to help you with that. So the commercial returns that maybe you will get out of the features that it has to offer to review an agreement to keep a track on what is happening in the agreement, I think this will definitely help with your returns. And again, like I've already raised a point in the past with regards to maverick spending, because I've seen issues in my past organizations where either payment is made or payment is accepted without following the company's SOPs, which which exposes a company to a lot of risks, I think. So if you can keep a track of maverick spend, I think that is again a very, very big brummy point for returns on this investment that you will make on the team.
Prerana, thank you for answering that question. I know it was a little off, not off topic, I would say, but a little different from what we would have expected. So the rest of the questions basically deal with, you know, what a CLM is. And I think we are a little ahead of that because we've talked about how it functions and, you know, the security measures, or for that matter, how it helps in negotiations and if there are any challenges or pitfalls. So I think it's a good time to wrap up. And any last thoughts, anything that you'd like to conclude with, Camelea?
For me to wrap up, first of all, thanks for inviting me. It was a good session, and I really enjoyed the discussion and the audience questions and the questions that we have exchanged. To conclude about the topic, for me, it's not a topic that's going to end up today or tomorrow. It's an ongoing topic. It's a developing topic. We shall not stop here. Artificial intelligence, it just started, as you said. So we should really invest time and money to implement it. It might be that today we will not see the benefit, or as the people asked before about the return of investment, but it's definitely a win. It's definitely a success. It's definitely coming, and people, they will see soon the difference. Those tools, for me, it's the future. It's a must for the moment. Before, there were options. But with our world, well, maybe I will see a mean thing thanks to the COVID, because the COVID, it wasn't a fun event. But by having this COVID, sadly, our lives changed. Our use of the online tools changed. Our use of, you can see now, trips have decreased. So team became the new airplanes, I can tell. So it seems, like you make the turn of the world. With these tools also, we have access wherever we are. So for me, it's a definite yes. We need to give it time to be installed, to take all the time to be trained, to ask the right questions if people have doubts, and to keep developing it inside the organization. So yeah, this is for me.
Thank you for those remarks, Camelea. What about you, Prerana?
Well, I definitely resonate with everything that Camelea has said. It is a nearly hour. It is budding. We're still working on it. It's still evolving. AI, like I've said before, is the heart of a contract management tool. It will continue to grow. We have still not explored the optimum potential of how AI can benefit a contract management tool. I think, I keep repeating myself, this is a need of the hour. There's a lot of time that is being spent that could be better utilized for a lot of things, only focusing on the legal field currently, that the legal resource can do in an organization. And if you can determine what your need is, and depending on the need, if you put in those few hours to identify the exact tool that you want and within your budget, I think it's gold. I think you should onboard it as soon as you can, get the training, put in those hours, drill it in the brains of your business partners that use the tool. The training will be given. But then even after the training is given, there's still going to be resistance. People saying that's just easy for me to send an email. But what people forget is, I think like Camelea had pointed out before, that you have those trackings, right? Who sent the document to me, when did I respond to it? All of that really helps a lot to keep everything on track, on check. Because I think, again, I'm forgetting the study, but I very recently read that on an average, when players are working on an agreement, it takes people some 6 to 5 weeks to close one particular agreement, right? Now, if you want to understand where the lag is, why is it taking so long? I think the contract management tool will really help a lot. So it's the need, identify why you need it, what your workflow is, find the best tool, and onboard it. It will definitely help save time, and that's the best return, I think, that you can get out of it.
Thank you so much for those thoughts, and I'm glad that we all realize that CMD tool or CLM tool is here to stay. And thank you both so much for joining in today. Manupatra is glad. I am glad, definitely, but Manupatra is really happy and proud to have both of you as their esteemed guests. And thank you so much for your time, for being so open, and such short notice, for being available and having such great insights, and with regards to everything that we've discussed, and with regards to every interaction that we've had. And I hope that Manupatra and we all stay in touch with you, and looking forward to more such meaningful conversations. And thank you so much for all those who attended the session as well. Hope you're getting some insights regarding the shift from offline to online contract management, and you're free to give us any feedback that you want. We are obviously available at contact@manupatra.com, and thank you so much, Prerana and Camelea, once again.
Likewise,
thank you so much.
It's a pleasure interacting with all of you.
Thank you.
I think this was a very informative session. I hope everybody's taking something back.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Have a good day. Have a good weekend.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.